This is Guardian Radio, your station for up-to-the-minute news, intelligent, interactive, and engaging conversation. 96.9 FM. The views and opinions of the hosts and guests are their own and do not necessarily reflect the position of the management and staff of Guardian Network.
From what day you may find out, certain people not like me. Everyone got a spaghetti now. Makes true me, I do it like Nike. But me not fear no guy now. No matter how hard them a spite me, me just a go and do me thing now. Me just a do it like Nike. 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 Them one poison me, throw me thing up. Plus me and them girlfriend a link up.
Hello.
Dog, where you did that when they think tough? No food, clean water for drink up. Now me and the dog, them a link up. Big truck, 20-inch rim, just a spin up. The pioneer just a kicks up. And a hip-hop apocalypse up.
Hello.
You can't see the star through the tint up. Plus me and the Cuban a link up. Rose gold so the Cuban link up. How much ice just a hammering up.
Okay.
From what day you may find
the Friday, March 1st edition of Talking Heads is on and popping. Your boy Naughty and your company right up until 6 p.m. on this Friday, March 1st edition of Talking Heads. Special guest today in the first hour, Mr. Cassius Stewart. We're going to have a great conversation with him. You know how to chime in. The lines will be open as soon as we get into it right after the break. So you know how to chime in. Here in New Providence, 323-6232, 325-4316, 325-4259. Toll free at any one of the Family Islands, 242-300-5720, 242-300-5720. Text lines powered by BTC, 422-GR96, 422-4796. Stream us live. Take us wherever you want to go. GuardianTalkRadio.com. That's GuardianTalkRadio.com. Cable channel 969, BTC Flow channel 612. That's how you get it in. That's how you get it on for fresh news, smart talk all day. Right here, Guardian Radio 96.9 FM. All right, quick break. Flip side of the break. We'll have a great conversation lined up and ready to go with Mr. Cassius Stewart as the Friday, March 1st edition of Talking Heads continues right after this.
Play with Island Games.
We making dreams come true.
Play with Island Games.
We paying more out to you. Don't mind the noise in the market. You getting cash in your pocket.
Cause Island Games is spicy, and spicy is tradition.
So when you play
Island Games,
we putting Bahamian's voice guaranteed to pay.
Island Games.
We like them other jokers. We've been here from the start, from the bike to computer.
Island Games.
We gonna make your dreams come true.
We playing with Island Games.
Cancer Treatment Centers of America is now City of Hope, creating one of the leading cancer care and research networks from coast to coast, providing more of what you need. More locations means more care closer to home. More specialists means more expertise. More research means more breakthroughs. More advancements means more treatment options. And more options means more hope. Learn more at cancercenter.com.
The new KFC Nuggets have arrived. That unlike the no-gets, ours are handmade using 100% white meat. Unlike the no-gets, at KFC, we hand-bread every day to achieve the perfect flavor. After you try our delicious and crispy nuggets, in the original recipe, you'll never settle for less. KFC, the real nuggets. It's finger-licking good.
This is Guardian Radio 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, all day.
We'll be right back.
We're back at you on the Friday, March 1st edition of Talking Heads. And my pleasure to have in studio with me. It's been a minute getting him here because I know he's got a busy schedule and he's been doing a lot of, he's doing the rounds on the talk show circuit. Mr. Cassius Stewart, how are you, man? Good to see you.
Naughty, it's always a good pleasure. Listen, always a pleasure. We've been supposed to get together so long.
I tell you.
And listen, I'm good and honored to be here to sit and talk with you, one of the greats.
Glad to have you, man. I appreciate that. And everybody good with you and yours? The family good?
Yeah, the family's good. Everybody's good. We all busy. Everybody moving, working. Kids, all, most of the kids are ready to go off the call. All the kids will be gone by this year.
Boy, you blink, you burp, you put on your cup of coffee, and there they go, out the door.
All of them gone. And so it's just, I tell my wife, we got to start and go buy some more children now.
Peace and quiet. You got to enjoy that for a little while, too.
Listen, a house is boring without children, man. You need
that's
the noise.
That's true, too, though. That is true. You need the noise. You miss the noise when it's not there.
Yep.
But speaking of the noise, a lot of noise in the political market, man. What's your take? Having, you know, been in part of many political incarnations, you know what I mean? Worn many hats, been in the arena. What's your take on the current political landscape that we have as far as, you know, the everyday Bahamian goes?
I mean, I think every Bahamian, honest Bahamian, would feel the way I feel, that, you know, we have a serious problem when it comes to crime. It's really vexing. It's like a cancer that is vexing that we can't seem to get our finger on and deal with. And so to see the level of criminality in our country where these men would shoot at women and children, would gun down people in cold blood in front of a crowd, would see these heinous crimes in broad daylight. And so every Bahamian is saying, you know, where are we going? How did we get here? And, you know, coupled with that, we see issues with our political leaders. We see one in court now, Ms. Adrian Gibson being in court, and we had more scandals on the next side. And now we have issues with this government. We see in the papers today about they're using taxpayers' money to travel. We saw the issue in the past with, you know, the Bermuda Triangle.
The Bermuda Gate was the first inference of that. Yeah. And you know,
if you're an honest Bahamian, you would not be happy. Now, if you're dishonest and you perhaps cling into a political party, then, you know, no matter what they do, you'll always be happy with what they do. But if you really truly love your country, you would not be happy with the state we're in, because we really want transparency, one. We want productivity, two. And we want leadership. And we want our leader to be the leader. And so you're elected to be the leader. We want you to lead. And so when it comes to crime, we have not seen anything other than, oh, we're going to amend the Bail Act. And, you know, which is quite striking to me, because what you're saying to me is that you're amending the Bail Act, but you're still giving bail to somebody. You're not, you're going to revoke.
Correct. And there are other loopholes in the judiciary that need to be closed, right, that's not being done.
Right. But also, too, you know, the guns coming into the Bahamas, it seems to be not only the Bahamas, but the whole Caribbean. There's a syndicate of people who are smuggling guns into the Bahamas. I'm advocating for execution or death penalty for gun smugglers into the Bahamas. So what you do is you shut down the program. So you say to anybody out there, any one of y'all who are caught smuggling guns in the Bahamas, we will execute you. No questions asked. That's a death penalty. I guarantee you 75% of the guns will stop coming in, right? So then you have these young men on the streets who are running out with high-powered rifles, whether it's AK-47 or whatever, shooting up the place. Life in prison without the possibility of parole. You go for good. Then for handgun, 25 years and 5 years for every bullet in the chamber. You have to set a good precedent when it comes to crime. Now, people say it's harsh. Well, if you don't commit the crime, then you ain't got to worry about nothing. If you ain't smuggling guns, then you ain't got to worry about being executed. You and I ain't getting a high-powered rifle, so we ain't worrying about that. So only for those who figure they need to go grab a high-powered rifle or weapon to go shoot up the place must worry about that. But we got to show them that we don't play when it comes to crime. But across the board, Naughty, you know, we need what we call order in government. We need discipline in government. We have so many undisciplined politicians who don't know the difference between their money and the country money. And that is why the people on the street figure they could do what they're doing, because the politicians are showing inconsistency with the law because they're violating the law every day. And so, you know, we have to have order across the board, whether it's the politician or the young man on the street with the handgun. We got to be a disciplined society. And really and truly, our constitution is really, really built on that, you know. Because, you know, the success of the Bahamas should be built on our commitment to self-discipline. And we need that discipline. And that is something that we have somehow strayed away from. And unless we get back to that, we're off track.
I think we stopped calling wrong for wrong. I mean, back in the day when we were younger, there were still, you know, advocates out there and folks that would stand up and say, listen, this is wrong. And they would call wrong for what wrong is and identify it.
Yeah.
I think
we
turn a blind eye to that. And I think we know a lot better, but we refuse to do better.
Well, you know, part of the problem, too, is that, you know, it's sometimes when you, you're benefiting from the regime, their wrong becomes right, even though it's wrong. And that is the sad thing. And so we've lost that moral compass. You know, it doesn't matter whether or not you're benefiting. If they are breaking the law, they're breaking the law. And so we cannot allow wrong to become right. And this is also the woke theory. This is where the transgender stem coming now, trying to cause everybody to say what they're doing wrong is right. And so it's what they call, it's a theory of relativism. In other words, your truth becomes relative based upon the circumstances.
Right, in the situation, yeah.
And so, you know, truth is never relative. It's always absolute. It doesn't change whether you believe so, whether anyone believes so, whether it's raining or summer. And so truth is always truth. And so we cannot get into relativism because that would destroy countries, that's what destroys families, and that's why the world is in the state it's in now, because we don't know what is truth anymore.
All right, let's go to the phone lines real quick, and then I got some text for you. Ready? Talking Heads, Guardian Radio 96.9 FM. Who's this?
Yeah, bless up, Naughty.
Hey, what's going on, 52?
Blessings.
Yeah, you know, those implementations would scare anyone, right? But then I'm looking at the whole chronology of the problem and us not having a national self-actualization. And then, like, really and truly, right, let's say both parties, the red and the yellow, right? This not this word about transparency, right? But it becomes apparent that respective administrations have not implemented the most integral part of transparency, which is the freedom of the information. So right now, to me, it's sickening to hear narratives about transparency, not from you, but from those entities who haven't done anything to implement it. And so I don't know about you. Without having the freedom of the information for me, it's like me going to court, right, and no evidence. So it's like without the freedom of the information, I cannot form my opinion of people. Because when certain information you learn, then you know what to think and analyze your opinion of them. So we are suppressing freedom of the information about everything, whether it be nefarious activity on the police force, there's no accountability. So yeah, it is now. You coming on saying fighting crime, but then we see where an officer was mixed up the other day. And we see their ability to suppress things and narratives even against them. It's too much power. It's a losing battle for any average person. You're not looking at it from a panoramic sense, Mr. Cassidy Stewart. I don't know if you look at it like that. You can't start fighting crime from C when you're forgetting A and B. We see where it's hard to get access to information. Let's say you don't hear anything about the arrest. You just heard the officer's arrested. You don't hear his charge. Everything is being concealed within that entity. But yet still, we're talking about fighting crime. But the crime fighters have to be weeded out and scrutinized also. So then how could we solve this conundrum? This is really a conundrum. And for decades, we have been denying corruption within all government entities and just rolling and letting the poor man get the short end of the stick. Now, with those implementations which seem very harsh, then also scrutiny within the judiciary, and we need to clean up everything in order for the law to be carried out, which is virtually impossible. So this is just all talk, my brother, because we're not willing to come together and do what we have to do, Mr. Cassius Stewart.
Well,
all right, 50, always good to hear from you.
Well, he brought some points up, but, you know, he seems to be, he needs clarity on some things. The first initial points I was talking about is basically dealing with guns, okay? We also need to implement what I call social engineering. We got to re-engineer our people. We got to re-engineer our young people into understanding the difference between right and wrong and being responsible. And so just like we engineer buildings, we engineer streets, we engineer car, we also got to engineer people. If you want productive people, if you want sensible people, that's not random. That's an engineering process that comes from the state. And so, you know, he wants the Freedom of Information Act. I mean, you know, I have no issues with the Freedom of Information Act, but that's not the be-all of end-all. I mean, you make decisions based upon information, and you are right. So if you have information, then you can make right decisions. You know, one police officer on the street who have been caught does not necessarily mean that all the police officers are complicit in a crime. And so we got to be very careful how we lump everybody in. on that. So yes, they did catch a police officer, and any police officer who are caught smuggling guns or committing crime should be punished more harshly than anybody else, because he should know better. And so there is no one variable in this equation to fix the end product. There are multiple variables in this equation. And so, you know, on a show which talks about 20 minutes, you can only be able to bring out some. And so you can't solve the whole world in 20 minutes. But I'm trying my best to try to create a picture for you to see that we need to move in a new direction so that we can begin to solve the problems. Freedom of Information Act, yes, we need that. You know, people need to know how to make decisions, and nobody should be able to cover up information. We need to know what the governments are doing. Government needs to be transparent. People need to know, because it's the people who hire them to be there. And so why you think that you can hide the information? And so it's where the first world is gone, and this is where we will go. But we just need to choose a better government.
All right, I got a couple of texts for you, Cassius. Afternoon, Naughty, to you and your guests. How come when a person commits a crime and is taken to court, they don't show the person's face who committed that crime?
Well, I mean, I'm not sure they don't. I mean, if the person is underage, they won't do that. I know that they would hide underage persons. If it's a female, I know they guard it with that as well, too. But normally persons who are walking across into court, they normally show their faces on TV. So I'm not sure what they're talking about.
I got another one for you here. Good afternoon, audience, and to Mr. Stewart. Regarding the execution for gun running and smuggling, what do we make of the Privy Council and their parameters for capital punishment in our regard?
Well, I don't support the Privy Council. I think we need to move away from the Privy Council, because the Privy Council has moved away from us. The Privy Council does not support the tenets of most Caribbean countries, and this is why you have several countries like Barbados and the rest of them has moved away from the Privy Council and embrace the CCJ. It's the Caribbean Court of Justice. The Bahamas is also a signatory to the Caribbean Court of Justice. We pay every year for the Caribbean Court of Justice to function, but we don't use them. And so we need to move towards the Caribbean Court of Justice. People who understand us, who feel us, who understand the culture of the Caribbean, and people who could adjudicate based upon the culture of the Caribbean.
The finger on the pulse. They know how we think in this region.
That's the word I was looking for. And so that's why I don't support the Privy Council.
Let's go to the phone lines real quick. Talking Heads, Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. Who's this?
It's your Papa, yeah, Naughty.
Hey, what's going on, Papa? All is well?
Yes, sir. Thank God for life.
You got a question for Mr. Stewart?
Yeah, Mr. Stewart, Happy New Year and everything. How you doing, buddy?
Papa, we ain't talking a long time, man. It's been years.
Yeah. I just enjoy listening to you and Shanique. I just want to follow up on, I have so many questions, but the time wouldn't allow. I just want to follow up on what that is you were saying. When you're saying that those things what the government need to do to show they're serious with this crime thing, you're talking about guns and bullets and people who mix up in this thing to show that you're serious. And tell me something. You think, like, the police, I believe we get hard-working police officers there. Only so far they just could go. Politics has play a role sometimes. You think they know where that judge is and they just ain't going to get that judge yet, or they already get him and it just ain't reached the news yet? And then that thing in Turks and Caicos Island, right? They say that ain't no old news, that new news. Sound like they closed the door on Haiti, saying because of the crime and the gang violence over there in Haiti, it's tripling down over there in Turks and Caicos. A lot of people have the opinion that that's just the same thing on a different level, what's happening here in the Bahamas. Do you think we need to head in that direction? I can hang up and listen. Keep up the good work, Cassius. Thanks, Naughty.
All right, Papa, no problem, man.
Well, Papa, you know, I've been talking for years about making sure that those who have illegal firearms get 25 years and 5 years for every bullet in the chamber. For high-powered rifles, no. I mean, I believe that they should get life in prison without the possibility of parole. And so we got to be serious. I'm not sure what judge you're talking about, but I can leave that one until you tell me some more about that. But I read the story on Haiti with Turks and Caicos and how they have decided to close the jaw and even suspend visas for Haitians traveling to them, because their situation is that they have people who coming and they're overstaying their welcome. And so they're suspending the visas for all Haitians traveling and blocking Haitians traveling to their country. Haiti is going through a serious crisis right now. And, of course, you know, the Bahamas has been trying to figure out how we can solve some of the problems of Haiti, because we are perhaps one of the first countries to get the brunt of the Haitian migration. Kenya, the problem with Kenya is that Kenya's was sending troops into Kenya, but the Supreme Court of Kenya has decided to stop that, and they banned their troops from coming in because they don't have no bilateral trade with Haiti, and so they can't send troops in. We were supposed to send 170 with the Kenya force, but since that's been suspended, I'm suspecting that we will also suspend ours. But Haiti definitely needs support, military support from the United States or the United Nations and or some of the European powers, some of the big powers. Canada has decided that they want to help, but the only thing they're going to do is send a boat on and then sail the seas, and they ain't gonna touch the shore. And so, you know, Haiti has to be fixed internally. And so someone got to take the lead of getting in on the ground and trying to restore order for Haiti, or else the whole country will be chaos, and then they're going to be coming to our shores. We can't do it. We don't have the manpower. We don't have the expertise to fix the problems of Haiti. In fact, we can't even fix the problems we have on our own shores. And so, but we need to agitate and continuously, draw on the United States and the United Nations to try to bring resolutions to the problems that Haiti are facing, or else we will be the ones suffering like we are suffering now.
All right, let's go to the phone lines real quick. Talk and Texas, I'm going to get to your text right now. Talking Heads, Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. Who's this?
Nolly, St. Petersburg, TGIF.
Hey, man, same to you, my brother. What's going on, St. Pete?
Hey, man, I like that, brother. Hey, look here. The Privy Council, man, they ain't nothing but some old white colonial, man. They never even set foot in the Caribbean. They don't, Obama's supposed to be an independent country, man. We should have our, you know, we should be able to do what we want to do or go to the Caribbean ports, man. You know, the criminals said, I need to get rid of them. But Naughty, hey, I just left Walmart today. Just now, I forget it's the first of the month. All these people get their welfare check, food stamp check, every disability check. Man, Walmart is like a madhouse. And then everybody on the road, I run into like three or four accidents. You turn through the side street, all the side streets block up. Man, it's a madhouse. First of the month. You know, people normally get their checks on the 3rd, but then the 3rd fall on a Sunday. Everybody get their checks today. And the food stores is a madhouse. Man, I'm about to grow some hair on my head. I'm so crazy, man.
I don't think that can happen. You can keep trying, but I don't know if that hair can grow no more.
Boy, Walmart is it's a madhouse. I'm telling you, boy. People fighting over the disability cards. Oh, my God. It's crazy, man. Woo! Lord mercy. But look here, man, hey, I just lift my heart up to the Royal Bombers Police Force. They doing their best, man. You know, and it's so sad they lock up these guys and these people right back out of the street. You know, that's why, man, it's so, you know, can't do it, man, you know. But I, you know, got to give thanks and praise to them, man, you know, because it ain't easy being a police nowadays, you know. Peace, Bahamas, 242 for life.
All right, but St. Pete, be safe, man. Take care. And we'll talk soon. I'm sure I'll hear from you in the... And the 5 o'clock is about talking sports. All right, I got a couple of more hits. Text for you, Cassius. Buckle up for this one. This is a long one. I continue to laugh when people talk about the implementation of a Freedom of Information Act as if that will change anything. Have we not seen what happens with respect to these acts? The Procurement Act was implemented. Is it being followed? He who implements also has to administrate. He who implements and administrates also enforces, if not administered properly, or administrated properly. There is no separation of powers which allows true accountability between the various branches.
Well, you know, the thing about the Freedom of Information Act, you know, a lot of people want it for various different reasons. Some may want it for the wrong reason, some may want it for the right reason. But the bottom line is you want transparency for your government. You don't want your government to be cloak and daggering on certain circumstances. In other words, you're asking for information about a particular issue, and because now they're cloaked, they can hide the information. And what if the information exposes some wrongdoing that they're doing? And so governments normally, you know, the whole point of the Freedom of Information Act was so that governments can be transparent, so no matter who wants this information, it's available to them. So if the media wants the information on the government spending in the last by-election, the government don't have to turn it over right now. But now, with the Freedom of Information Act, it allows them to provide the information. It's not just be-all of end-all. It doesn't solve all the problems. Some people think it does, but it doesn't. But it's a good tool to be able to be free of hiding information. And right now, you see one of our former ministers are in court now. And if, you know, we need to be able to have access to information that was done in the ministry.
All right, Carl, I'm coming to you in a second. Let me get these texts. Real quick. Naughty asked Mr. Stewart about how we can bridge the economic gap in the country, since the biggest problem many Bahamians face, especially post-pandemic, is financial survival.
Well, the problem with the Bahamas is that most of the economic wealth is tied to the government or political powers, parties. And so most Bahamians who have been successful, can tie their wealth directly to a political party, a contract, and so on, which is a bad thing, because you need to be able to grow independent of a political party, independent of the government. In other words, your success shall be determined by your own mental aptitude or your aptitude or how hard you work. Some people didn't work hard. They just know a politician, and the politician give them a lick, and the next thing you know, they're successful. But you've been to school, and you're working hard, and you're busting your hip every day, and then you can't get two coins to rub together. We have to free the economic system, one. And how do we do that? We have to allow the Bahamas to tap into the $4 trillion e-commerce market so that our success, our wealth, is not tied to a PLP or an F&M. Right now, when you look at our economic success, the governor of the central bank says that 9 out of 10 bank accounts in the Bahamas have less than $300 in it. So 90% of all the bank account holders in the Bahamas got less than $300. So that means the whole country broke, right? Only 10% of the bank accounts in the Bahamas got 300 plus or more. And so that means that's a sad recipe. So how do we fix that? We have to fix that by first encouraging entrepreneurship and freeing up. Right now, the government had a $62 million contract for consultants in the last budget, right? You know, most of those consultants more than likely would have been foreigners. Why don't you engage Bahamians? Make Bahamians millionaires. You know, you could have filtered that $62 million somehow through the economy so the Bahamians can benefit. We need to make sure that the wealth that we are now seeing is passed on. So we have $2 billion projects on one island alone. The only country in the world that has $2 billion projects in such close proximity to each other, right? Atlantis and Bahama. And most of the people still broke. So obviously we got to revisit this tourism product and figure out now, if the wealth is not trickling down to the average man, then how do we fix it? But like I said also too, but when you look at in the 1980s, when the tourism boom happened, it was the politicians that put themselves in the way to benefit. So you go to the airport and you look at the gift shops, find out who owns it, probably a politician, mm-hmm. right? You go to the port, find out who owns all the stores where the tourist comes in, it's the politician.
Who caters to all the airlines?
You go to
the politician.
Who providing the food for all of the airlines? The politician. Who providing the fuel? It's the politician. When you go into the hotels, you look into the gift shops, who's providing that? It's the politicians. And so what they have done was they used their position as leaders to hog up everything. And whilst the people, yeah, you get a job, yeah, you as a waitress, yeah, you as a maitre d', yeah, you as a bellman, but you're only making enough to come back to work next week. And so while these people are taking home the whole hog, and so yeah. You're getting the crumbs of the crumbs, but then they want you to be satisfied with that. And now the talk in the community that I'm hearing is that they blaming the poor people for being poor. You can't blame the poor people for being poor when you're all putting roadblocks in the people's way, when nobody could. Every time you try to take one step further forward, you go backwards, and then you all rig the race. The race is, this is the finish line. You starting at the finish line, and you got us 10 meters behind the start line. Right. You're rigging the race. But then you blaming us for being poor. You can't do that. You're rigging the race. These guys them got everything made. They got everything. When you eat bread, it's the politician. When you get gas, it's the politician. When everything is them. And so now, you know, for me, it's saddened, but because we keep supporting them. You blame them for keeping you poor and keeping you broke, but you keep supporting them. I mean, it's like a never-ending street, eh? It's
a like a mouse on a wheel, like a hamster on a wheel, just round
and
circles.
So we got to fix the economic system. We got to break it. 30 minutes from the Bahamas on a plane is the richest economy that ever existed. How many Bahamians are generating money from the richest economy that ever existed? Little or none. We got to find a way to tap into the U.S. market. Instead of going to Miami to shop, go to Miami to figure out how to start a business. There's nothing stop you from operating in the U.S.
All right, we could go over into the 5 o'clock if it needs be, if you got the time. Because sure. The phone line's blowing up and the text line's blowing up. And let's get to the callers. Talking Heads, Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. Who's this?
Hey, Naughty, how you doing?
Hey, what's going on, man?
Cassie Stewart.
Yes, sir.
You're a politician that used to live in Garden Hills?
Yes. Yes, sir.
Yeah, I remember I used to do some heavy equipment work for you back in the day.
Yes, yes.
Yeah. What 52 had to say, I think, was credible, and what you're saying is credible also, that, you know, you have to pay attention to the woman, the youth, and what he's saying is basically, I think his point is that when you're looking at the politicians or whoever they are, it's like you're trusting the fox to watch the chicken coop.
Chicken coop, they're robbing you blind.
You see what I'm saying? Yeah, mm-hmm. You understand? But, Naughty, you know, I've been agitating, and I keep saying and calling about them not answering my letter, right?
Correct.
And when you look at what the country is preparing for, Freedom of Information Act, if I need the information that has already been rejected by the government, and now it's been 16 months I've been asking for it to just give an update of that rejection, that's information that only could come from them, right?
Right.
Okay. So, what are we dealing with? You know, they think we're stupid. You know what I mean? But anyway, the flying crew need to get it right, man. That's it. Okay?
All right, my brother.
Yeah, take care.
And we're going to keep pushing that for you as well until you get your restitution, man, and restitution. Talking Heads, Guardian Radio 96.9 FM. Who's that?
Yeah, blessed, Naughty. Mr. Stewart, I just wanted to call back. Yeah, I appreciate schoolmate, man. I appreciate the last call. Listen, Naughty, what I'm saying is, I did Mr. Stewart, he even opened up my eyes more. But see, what I'm saying is, when it comes to the freedom of the information, it is beyond politics, even though his disclosures that he mentioned previously are all well and good for the Beeman people. But my mind is open, and I'm not limited like the texter. And so most people, true for political fanaticism, what they would do is they would sacrifice the morals and ethics out the door for the existence of the party. The party comes first. So that is the first. We need a revolution of the mind. Some people say black is white and white is black because of politics. So I get what Mr. Stewart is saying, but what I'm saying is for me, the freedom of the information is multifaceted. Suppose they want to find out chemical constituents in the coastal seawater about the situation in Maradona the other day with the hydrocarbons or constituents in the water. Economical information, social information, and scientific information. So my mind is beyond the politics. You know, that's all I'm saying. So the text was quite insulting for me to suggest that the freedom of the, he's right. Because the government, you, Mr. Stewart, too, right? Listen to me, my brother. You're not on the ground. We are denying the level of corruption in the police force. I'm not giving any discredit to police officers who go there and work hard, my brother. My power is the police. I know some police officers are decent. But don't tell me a few bad apples when you don't have the data and you can go in the archives and look at it. See, we got to stop upholding these narratives. Back in the days, we had the police officers doing the things they're doing now. So why are we playing naive? You know, Mr. Paul Thompson could call because he came back from Rainy Days, and he could show you the social difference. You ever see police officers fighting in the station before? You don't know the animosity that exists within the force. My power is the police. Some days I'm told I can't turn the radio. We need to stop this. You see the foolishness in the states. Cameras just being implemented. The gospel according to the police cannot survive in a democracy when you're saying you're fighting crime. The crime holders must be scrutinized and as be seen to be upholding crime in order to create a good PR with the public. That's all I'm saying is they need to come forward and make statements, give accountability. This is only what people are asking for, man. You know, you're talking about the poor. Who do you think will be affected by these things? The poor, my man. All guys, you all got to open up your lives and listen to people and stop discrediting people and talking about degrees on the radio, my brother. We have to turn around and listen to facts and don't be visceral. I'm talking facts, man. Some things can be said. There's no narrative against an entity that people have a disadvantage to in every which event. They control everything from the crime scene straight to the court. Bless up.
Right, 52, you're hot today. Let's get to the phone lines. Talking Heads, Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. Who's this?
How you doing, Naughty? How you guys doing? Mr. Stewart, how you doing?
Hey, what's going on, Anton?
Blessings.
This ain't Anton.
No, do you know
him? Oh, wait. I thought you were doing an Anton impersonation today, but it's not like Anton today. Anyway, what you got for me?
But, Naughty, Mr. Stewart hit a vital point, and he's speaking about how tourism products, but I always speak about, because I'm involved in the tourism industry, and I always speak about the leakages, of tourism. And we speak about 9 million visitors coming to our shores, and we brag.
We have money on the ground for them 9 million. I want to see that, though.
But the thing is, before, you ever hear about the concept of yo-yo tourism? Yo-yo means the money, first of all, every dollar, 20 cents before the tourists even land on the ground, 20 cents then gone. Because when you book Airbnb, whatever, that money stays in America.
Right.
that stays in America. Everything we import, like, yeah, Stuart said, everything we import, when those people book their tours, that happening over there on the ground, you know. When they get here, who owns all the hotels and the resorts? American companies. American companies.
And all stays outside our border.
It's repatriated. Although you see it comes in, it goes right back out. Yo. And we get a small percentage. I am all for the foreign investor. I mean, all for building a tourism brand. We advertise and spending a lot of money on a brand. We spending money on promoting to bring people here. For the people to take the money right back out. Mm-hmm. We got to be able to utilize the brand to build our industry. Same as Bahamas Air. Bahamas, we need to buy more jets because when Bahamas Air fly people in, the money is here. All American and Delta and all that stuff that get out of the country. We've been in the industry for far too long for Bahamans not to be involved in this product. And then you can come to me now after advice. You say, hey, tourism is everyone's business.
Only
when
only
the fellow over the hill don't feel it. And they saw it's a disconnect. Mm-hmm. We start looking at you sideways and saying, brother, you are one and everything in this industry, and you telling me I must, it's everyone's business, and we must behave ourselves. I'm trying to eat.
I got
you, Carla. You see the disconnect?
I see it every day. I'm going to let Mr. Stewart respond. Good call.
See, Naughty, what we have essentially done is we've built a country around Bahamians, but not for Bahamians. In other words, this whole industry that we've built from 1970-something to now, you know, it's being built, but it's not really built for the people. We were built to support it, but we're not built to benefit from it. You know, you build a hotel with casinos, but as a Bahamian, you can't own the casinos, but the casinos is the biggest, largest generator in the hotel. In other words, $250 million they export every year in terms of in profits. But what if a Bahamian had owned that? You understand? And so we built this country, but it's not for us.
I hear, you know, it's very interesting. I hear people talking about, you know, I hear Club Landor, you know, is up for grabs. $11 million for Bahamian entrepreneurs is not a hefty price, you know.
No. How much is it? 11?
$11 million. You don't think four or five, you know, affluent Bahamians should come together and happen and get a stake in it?
Well, Bahamians can do that. I mean, it just takes Bahamians for his doing their due diligence and getting on the ground and put the plan together to get the hotel.
But I'm saying that to say that it's the same way that you said we should be in a foreign market. There's niche markets right now that we could monopolize business in the United States.
For the first time in probably 40 to 50 years, Bahamians benefit from the tourism product is through Airbnb. This is where Airbnb and Camp Road and all right now. And
so I mean all over.
And so people are now getting the tourist dollar. Otherwise, it was secluded to the hotels and Atlantis and Paradise Island and out west. But now people throughout New Providence and the islands are now getting actually the tourist dollar. And that had nothing to do with the government.
Right. That had to do with the government.
So some entrepreneur in the U.S. came up with this concept, and now everybody can now benefit from a couple of dollars in the tourist product. Now, the thing about it is, how do we expand on that? You see? We have to expand on it. But don't knock them. Look at Jim Breezes. Issa and Bush George. And, you know, these are Jamaican products. They took their money.
And invested
built a brand.
And accident products are still going strong today.
The problem with the Bahamas is that we don't have a concept of beyond our borders, business beyond our borders. And so I put a concept where Bahamas beyond our borders, where we could put together teams of Bahamians and we can go into Jamaica and buy up all the business and own the industry. Go into Trinidad and own the industry standard. Go into Dominica and St. Lucia and own them. They come into us. Well, they're here.
We got to get to this caller, Cassius, but I got a bevy of texts for you and more calls to deal with right after the news, including tell us a little more about Operation Ozone. I got like three or four texts telling me you need to let Cassius talk on Operation Ozone. So you got your request coming up. You got your texts chiming in. So.
And I
got
to pick up my daughter for five.
Oh, Lord. Boy. If you can't go over into five, that's cool. Or if not, because I know you might have commitments. If you do want to reschedule, that's good,
Mark,
too.
Listen, I always listen. To reschedule with the great, I would be delighted.
All right, but real quick, then, before we get out and get to this text, just real quick, couple of things. Quick thoughts on the recent budget. Anything jump out to you that Bahamians should pay attention to?
Well, first of all, you know, look at our debt service ratio, looking at the amount of money we're spending. We're spending a hell of a lot of money. While the government says that there's an increase in revenue, but there's also increase in expenditures. And so every time there's a jump in revenue income coming in through different taxes, there's always a jump in expenditure. So the debt service ratio last budget was 100.4. This time around, they're saying it's 86% up to this point. I'm suspecting now when we look at for the rest of the fiscal period, we may go above 100% again. Now, debt service ratio is a serious indicator. In other words, if you go to the bank to borrow money, the bank will tell you that if your debt service ratio is above 35%, you're at risk. They can't lend you no money. The Bahamas government debt service ratio is 100.4%. In other words, we are beyond risk. This is why when we borrow now, we borrow at a higher interest rate.
Correct, interest.
Yeah, so we have to be careful, because what happens is that when we can't borrow no more, then what's going to happen is the whole economy is going to feel the pinch. In other words, you need, because between salaries and interest payments on the loan accounts for 97% of the whole budget. Salaries and interest payments, 97% of the budget. Now, how do we now factor in paying the rest of the things? We got to go borrow. So we're borrowing about $800 million within this period just to function. And so we got some serious problems, because this government don't have a problem spending money. They seem to love spending money. And so there's no ease. There's no austerity measures. There's no saying, okay, listen, let's ease the pressure on the spending so that we could bring the spending down and so that we could be able to do some things and we don't have to borrow that much money. But they don't seem to care. So you borrowing $250 million for this new hospital. But on top of that, you borrowing an additional $500 million just for the government to function. And so that's, what, $700 million, and that ain't at the end of the fiscal period yet. So you're looking at $1 billion in this one period now. We have a $12 billion debt now. So we got to be very, very careful, because we're going to find ourselves where our debt exceeds our GDP. And then what's going to happen is that this is when the heavy hitters come in from the IMF and say, listen,
yeah. We
may have to devalue the dollar and so on and so on and so on. So we got to be very, very careful where you have a government that don't have a problem spending money, and Brave don't have a problem spending money.
All right, Callers Texas, I appreciate you all chiming in. We got it from Mr. Stewart. He'll be back, so we'll line up a part two to this in very short order, possibly even next week if he's free, so we can continue. Because there's still issues that, Texas still want to talk about crime, want to talk about e-commerce, want to talk about the green economy, the blue economy. Phone lines are lit. I mean, Mr. Producer Damon, they've been lit the whole day. So we got to do this. If you available next week or the week after, we'll pick this up right where we left it off.
Monday's good. You on Monday?
Monday might be good too. Let's pick it up on Monday, and
let's
continue it on Monday. Good stuff.
Yes.
All right. Have a great weekend, and I'll see you Monday, Cassius.
Love you, buddy.
Back at you, man. Be safe.
Yes.
All right. We'll take the break. Flip side of the break. Right after the news, we'll get up in the sports in the 5 o'clock hour, and we got lots to talk about. Good stuff, Qualis. Good stuff, Texas. Sorry to disappoint. We'll pick it up on Monday, right where we left it. All right? The Friday, March 1st edition of Talking Heads continues right after this, and it's the first of the month, so Bone Thugs got to take us to the break. You know that.
John Shoes and Accessories is your one-stop shop for all your footwear needs. You will find what you're looking for among the growing collection of classic and trendy styles with new arrivals every week. John's covers the whole family and has great prices, helpful and friendly customer service. Your experience shopping with us will be time well spent. Shop with us online at www.johnshoes.com. John's also now carries small home appliances. So come on into John's, located on Rosetta Street in Palmdale and Carmichael Road West. John's, we put fashion at your feet.
Struggling to repay your loan? Let us help you get back on track with payment terms that suits your financial situation and improve your credit score and credit report with the Bahamas Credit Bureau. Inquire about our restructured loans today. Call us at 356-7764.
Just because they were cheap,
Keisha bought things that she really didn't want. Hungry for deals? Let KFC satisfy your cravings before you do something crazy. Get the new Kentucky Crunch Sandwich with a juicy KFC chicken filet, fresh lettuce, and the perfect amount of mayo topped with a fluffy sesame seed bun for just $5.75. Order your new favorite sandwich online with Messenger or WhatsApp Hi to 557-3663 to start your KFC order today. KFC knows value. It's finger-licking good.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas.
Recording in progress.
First and now we're smoking, joking, rolling, buzzing, sipping on 40 ounces. Again, come, come, we get to the front. Stay busting all nights, we ride. Take the black to wear, night at night. I give up my partner, they give me some yay, so double up to the sweat you need. We get to really get P.O.D. thing for the green leaf. Give it up for the first to show, but it lay low. Cause the poor boy creep when they roll so low. Break it, they can't get away, but it don't stay, yeah, yo, keep your bankroll. Yeah. We're having a celebration. Should have stay high. You can never leave, but it's time to grind. I'm down for my crime. After crime, finna creep to the bed, cause mom's got a grub on the grill. If we got the bow, oh, you know it's the first of the run that my jewels, we ducks for real.
Wake up, wake up, wake up, it's wake up, wake up,
pick up, and I seen the And my sister was already dead. She said, I'm a running go get in my stance. Watch, I make sure no one snatches my check. And that's the mail, man. Sold in the mail and put it up in the mail pocket. So they hit it and land it down. They give me a dump about 10 dockets. But ain't no bucket ride that reader. Hop on the 10 to the clip. Ready to get him up with him at first. And to catch that dumb, man, I gotta get there. Player, player, holler, holler. Say, like Claire, got much to offer. When I'm a peeps on 93, I'll open the clock like for some dollars. So get it back again. Yeah, I want a quarter out. Oh, one of my clusters got the same. And we gonna run it all up the smoke. Tell them every day she's the hydro. We know what the cut, so the bus to the popo. Toss it to Giga, then roll with the corner, same old. Running through the alley, get in the mallet. Hop at the second of sundown. No front from January, no 9 of December. I'm loving the first of the month.
Wake up, wake up, wake up. It's wake up, wake up. Get up, get up, get up. Wake up, wake up, wake up. Wake up, wake up.
Gotta grind, gotta get mine. In the hood that I claim and I swing on the double nine. Gotta find them dubs. Only got 40, can I thug it love? What's up? Come and thug on my corner. Begging be a donor. St. Clair thugs don't like that. And selling them dummies, making that money. Come back, all them in the stuff crack. From the first to the 15th, thug them up pretty cheap. But I gotta save, gotta come up. Put it all in the cup. Wanna get loaded, they're gonna stow. Grab a couple loads, style a roll to the bag. Count on my profit and add it to the stash. Gotta watch my back, see you lay your head be up. Out to rob me, fools. But never no shows and no losses. Don't be keeping these buzzers up off me. See, gotta sell a whole block. Spin a couple bills, thug. Burn a lot of green on the fur.
Wake up, wake up, it's wake up, wake up. Get up,
wake up, wake up, wake up. It's wake up, wake up, get up. Waking up, feeling buzz up early in the morning. Stretching them down, that lightweight bitch. Take a fist to the dawn. It's like I got geek with my chum. But it's the press, I'm getting me hustle long. Hop on the phone, calling the crazy phone. Wanna know, did your OG check come?
She put me down.
I'm home on the bus with busy
noise, get drunk.
And I'm coming with a bunch of that funk from home. Here I come, T, put me down. Oh God, how I love when it first come around. Now I'm freaking me black and mild. Running through time.
See, the first get celebrated. Rushing to the pot cause I wanna get faded. Looking on wild cause I'm needing me hair braided. We heavy off into this game. Two to the first, just call me that pro slang. Them records from the east to the west coast. Making that money all across the world, man. Ain't gonna say clear true. And I know the record late tonight. But I gotta make a living, so I ask the Lord to keep my homeboys high. We be coming up on ears, all about making more. Wanna first get a fifth, but don't flip. Getting live with the bump, that's poetic hustlers in the graveyard shift. On the first. Wake up, wake up, wake up. It's wake up, wake up. Get up. This way faster, wake up, get up, get up, get up, catch your chest, get up, wake up, wake up, this way faster, wake up, get up, get up, get up, catch your chest.
We're back at you on the Friday, March 1st edition of Talking Heads. Your boy, Naughty and your company, right up until 6 p.m. Probably going to zoom in short order. And I know, you know, I got a text earlier. Naughty, we need to hear some AFC offseason news. Apart from the Dolphins, get Statboy to break down the Ravens, the Steelers, and some of the other AFC teams. So text us since you asked the Statboy, you will get Statboy in short order, all right? And Pearly will be zooming in a second. Let's get to the phone lines real quick. Talking Heads, Guardian Radio 96.9 FM. Who's this?
What's going on, Naughty?
What's going on?
Everything cool, man.
What's happening?
How you doing?
I'm good, man. How you doing?
Everything cool. I see you giving other people my name today.
Boy, I tell you that. Somebody trying to impersonate you, man, Anton. I had like two texts say, but they got on Anton 2.0.
I know you in the sports hour. I'm not calling the dog politics. I'll be listening in to catch up on that conversation. Hopefully it happens on Monday.
On Monday, man. We'll continue it Monday. Make sure to call in early on Monday, man.
Yeah, I missed out on that this afternoon. I was trying to get one or two things.
It was candid. Phone lines were hot, text lines still full.
Yeah,
so.
I was able to gather. It sounded like y'all was talking about the economy and tourism, eh?
Well, generally just getting a take on what Mr. Stewart, you know, how right, he sees the political landscape. His opinion, correct.
We need plenty of conversation on that because it has to happen.
Yeah, man.
No fish crack, Naughty.
Yeah, man, you and the farm have a good weekend, Monday, and make sure, hit me up Monday, man, for sure. All right? Be safe, Anton.
You
say me, brother. All right, bro, be safe. Bless. But now that we're into the time, let's check out today in sports history. Hey, Pearly Simo.
What's up,
Hey, buddy, what you saying?
I'm good, man. Listen, and on behalf of my family and the whole crew here, I talking as my condolences to you and yours. I know you was funeralizing today, so we appreciate you chiming in all things considered.
Possible. I think, let me go find me a nice quiet corner.
Okay.
You have to do the show. Just go and do the show. So I'm here.
Devin, put something cold in your glass for you to do the show. You had a repast. Have one for me there, Kornheiser. All right. Have one. Have one for Kornheiser. Have one.
It's very green. I'll do that for you, sir.
Hey!
The people from out of town left the church, right? And decided to stop the Sbarros to get something to eat. And then they come here, I say, but you never been to Bohemian Funeral Lake.
Don't
go buy food after Bohemian. You just come to the people tell you come to the house, food and drinks there.
They'd have been better off going to KFC. Or Tropical Gyros, or Naughty Johnny's, or Burger King.
I say, you should have gone to KFC or Burger King. I said, but in the meantime, you don't have to go to no place when you come to Bohemian Funeral. You come straight to the house.
That's what I'm talking about.
And my family like to eat, so you know it's a spread of food to feed all these people.
Right, I know you told him, but I told one plate for your boy, please. Thank you.
Plate and pack, and I'm a lady holding that for me, man.
Bang, bang, Lulu. That's what I'm talking about. All right, today in Sports History, all brought to you, of course, by Naughty Johnny's. Happy hour going on right now, 5 to 7 p.m. every Wednesday, every Friday at Naughty Johnny's. Be sure to check them out. Well worth the trip out there to the Old Fort Shopping Plaza. Great highball specials, great food specials. Give them a call, see what they got going on. 377-7776. And don't forget, they got breakfast, all right, on Saturday and Sunday. Breakfast starting at 9 a.m. All right, on this day in sports history, 1941, Elma Leyden was named the first commissioner of the NFL. 1949, Joe Louis announced that he was retiring from boxing as world heavyweight boxing champion. 1960, Gordie Howe was profiled in Look magazine. 1969, Mickey Mantle announced his retirement from baseball. 1979, the NCAA granted ESPN the exclusive rights to telecast collegiate events. 1987,
I did watch Angel last night.
Thank God they made that decision in 1979, hump early. 1987, the Boston Celtics defeated the Detroit Pistons 112 to 102 to post win number 2,235 as a franchise. 1988, Wayne Gretzky of the Edmonton Oilers got his 1,050th assist to become the NHL all-time leading assist leader. Gordie Howe had held the record for 26 years, and Gretzky got that in 88, my brother. You understand what I'm saying? And the beautiful thing about Gretzky, if you take away all his goals and you just go based on his assists, he's still got more points than anybody else. Crazy statistic right there. If there's ever a GOAT, undeniable GOAT of a sport, Gretzky and hockey, hands down. 1996, Lenny Wilkins won his 1,000th game as a coach in the NBA. 1996.
Recording in progress.
Hey, Burley, you unmute. We'll fix yourself, Burley. The Dallas Mavericks set a record when they attempted, in 1996, the Dallas Mavericks set a record when they attempted 44 three-point shots in a game against the Vancouver Grizzlies. 1997, Bottom Line 2 debuted on ESPN 2. 2002, the Vancouver Canucks said that they would bill Ed Belfour, Dallas Stars, for damaging the visiting team's locker room on February 28th. Belfour broke two televisions, a clock, and a VCR, and damaged the walls of the dressing room after he was pulled during the first period. 2005, the NHL's Board of Governors met and emerged fully behind Commissioner Gary Bettman and totally committed to having a season in the fall. And your sports quote of the day, you can see a lot by observing Yogi Berra.
Yogi. I didn't figure that's going to be Yogi.
Yogi got some of the best quotes ever, ever.
Yeah,
ever,
some real ones. Yeah, some really good ones.
So, Purdy.
Hey.
Let's check out the local scene, all brought to you, of course, by Burger King Nassau. Be sure to check them out. They got time.
I had an opportunity today to meet the number one junior tennis, under 14 junior tennis player in the Bahamas, young lady by the name of Caitlin Pratt out of Grand Bahama.
Oh, wow.
She's leaving on Sunday with the team, three-player team to go to El Salvador for a junior tournament.
Okay.
So I had the opportunity to sit with her. I had an opportunity to sit with her and have a conversation. A very sharp, very smart young lady, tall for 13. But I told her I'm going to be watching for her. I said, we're going to check the papers Monday, and we're going to talk about you on the show. So we're talking about it today.
So talk about it then.
No, I mean, we talked about it. She, you know, she has good grades. She goes to, I think, some Christian school, Freeport Christian Academy or something. I can't remember the name of the school. But she loves tennis, smart, sharp in the conversation and all that, very mannerly. And she's excited about traveling. This is the first time my parents are not traveling with her, so they said she's already been on 2 trips and did well. So I wish her well,
man. Good stuff.
Congratulations to her and the team, and I hope they do well.
And we offer the same sentiment. Now, let's check out some other local news. The Raptors win their 4th straight GSSSA title. Knights take over lead from Stingrays in the senior division. The C.H. Reeve Raptors won their 4th straight Government Secondary School Sports Association Track and Field Championships on Thursday.
They have a strong junior team.
891 points to beat the second-place S.C. McPherson Sharks by 383 points. The Sharks finished a distant second with 508 points, and the H.O. Nash Lions ended up third with 490 points. So they're trying to say, like, they're a sack of GSSSA is what they're trying to say, Purdy. That's what
they
think.
Yeah, they, and junior, I think C.R. Walker's the next school that's in the senior that's leading, right?
I think so.
That's the sack of track.
Right, C.R. Walker took the lead from the C.V. Bethel Stingrays in the senior division.
Yeah. But the BAISS is on Wednesday coming. So I understand it's going to be a good meet. I understand a school that don't wear the same color I wear. Bragging about how they're gonna mash sack up. You know, you give 80 scholarships, you should be a rather strong team, eh?
Should be.
Don't lose. Because if you lose, you know, I will be that guy all next week.
You will be that guy.
Oh yeah. But probably, you should think about doing the show from there maybe one day, because I might do the show Thursday from there, if that's possible. We'll see.
We'll try and make that happen for you, brother.
Through their sponsor.
Glad to see that he's telling the Guardian the same thing that he told Talking Heads. Boleg Confident Pool will be ready. 2 years ago, it was announced that the Bahamas would be hosting the 2024 Carifta Aquatics Championship. Fast forward to February 2024, one would see that the Betty Kelly Kenning National Swim Complex is being renovated, with local swimmers and coaches unable to prepare in the facility to go after 6 straight Carifta title. Minister of Youth, Sports and Culture Mario Bolle gave his assurance earlier last week that the facility will be up and running before Carifta, which is set from March 28th to April 7th. It is expected
so you got 27 days.
It is expected to for us to test the pool by putting water in the pool on Thursday, yesterday, or Friday, today of this week, and then we will continue moving from there.
Well, they had some. They announced yesterday, it was in the paper in the Guardian yesterday, and I spoke about it for a minute, that they have some delays. And
now
that
the trials
will not be held. The trials have to be held at a different site.
Yeah, the Bahamas Aquatics Federation Carifta trials, dubbed the Last Chance Meet, set for March 8 tonight, will not be held at the complex, but instead at the King's College 25-meter pool on the Western Road. Boleg said they do not want to rush work on the Betty Kelling facility. Oh, man.
Naughty.
I got to continue to give Mr. Boleg the benefit of the doubt, because he was candid, he was honest, he was forthright when we reached out to him. But boy, I tell you, I think people making him look bad by giving him one set of information.
To be well, but I guarantee you they're going to be running around there on the 27 to 28, painting and trying to finish that up. Watch.
Yeah,
and guess what? If it's not ready, there's no excuse. It's been a year, almost a whole year.
2 years.
All right? No,
when we knew we were hosting it.
No excuse that pool shouldn't be ready. And if we're short of money, we shouldn't spend our money on anyway. Let's move on. Sorry.
Well, I'm traveling in Orlando, looking at Minnie and Mickey. Or anyway,
yeah.
We could leave.
Yes.
Or maybe if we knew if the Bermuda Gate money was paid back, we could apply it elsewhere.
See, that's another story for another day.
Boys advanced to the finals. Girls to play for bronze. The Bahamas won both of its quarterfinal matches of the Junior Billie Jean King Cup, Junior Davis Cup, North Central American, and the Caribbean pre-qualifying tournaments. This was in Santo Domingo, Dominican Republic, which you just talked about. And
no, this is different. This is something different.
All right.
Juniors, that's above 14. This under 14 that came
in. Perfect. And the boys will now move up to the championship round. They're going to face Trinidad and Tobago.
Well, that's a tough game.
So they'll keep you... posted on the results, which went down at 9 this morning, the event. So we'll get to them as soon as they break. And that's a wrap on the local scene right there.
Sounds good.
Now let's slide international. And, of course, you know, it's all brought to you, of course, by Tropical Gyro, who's in and who's out. And
so while we're talking about local scene, there was a gentleman that called the show yesterday looking for you, Naughty.
And who is that gentleman?
Say, you Ryan, you're talking, but what you do to him in Mason's Edition, did you tell him he dunk on you in Mason's Edition?
No, he never dunked on me now. I was close to the scene of said dunkage, but I was not the individual officially dunked on.
But between him and Muff, I forget the brother name. Forget his nickname. But anyway, he can call.
Yeah, you need to call him back.
Muff say they dunk on you. Say he dunk on you.
Muff ain't never. Listen, that's Muff mouth talking.
No,
okay?
Muff ain't say he. No, Muff said he. The guy dunk on you. Muff ain't say he dunk on you. Muff
no,
said
sir. Dunk on you. I might have been close by to the dunkage, but see, when I used to play on courts like Mason and them, right? They got a nice shot at 3.9. So you know, Ice Baby was on. Vinny Del Negro was in full effect. There go the call right there. Let's jump on in. Talking Heads, Guardian Radio 96.9 FM. Who's this?
The Great Naughty.
Hey, what's going on, Muff Roll?
No, it's Killer Boo, man.
Hey, what's going on, Killer Boo?
But what I was saying, for Ellie,
no,
I wasn't
stop.
He don't call Naughty. Naughty was saying he don't call him.
No.
Who called to clear that up?
No. Stop. Pick up the Skillaboo, all right? I never said I dunked on Skillaboo.
Okay.
I said I drank a couple jumpers on Skillaboo then.
Right. One thing
my claim to fame is, the J was always available from the car. We pull up, you know, just add water, release, rotation, splash.
Right.
So,
right.
You know, I was good.
He'll be calling to straighten up with you.
Yeah, man, but I remember Skiller plenty times over there, man. We had some big games there.
Well, Naughty, you know, he are visually impaired now, so he say Dynamo's be texting you.
No. And you know why he visually impaired? I hate to say it. I was all them jump shots I hit in the eye. I shoot the eye out. That's what happened. Skiller, I saw you come out. Had to come out. That's Muff who bring that up, man.
Yeah. But finally, I thought we needed a hero and we needed some love. I thought Hero was back last night, man, but I need some stuff. But we cut it from 16 to 2 couple times. But we short a tiny prince. But love, man, he can come right there and jack up Love ankle, man. Of course, Love to be out. That's what bugged me.
Yeah.
But I see we could beat them in 7. We didn't come back. A full LC Miami, we could beat them, man, with Love, the Wright brothers. Scary Terry missed a couple trees. The thing ain't touched him because he legs ain't back yet. He just come back.
And you know what, Muff? I know him. Excuse me.
What are you saying, Naughty?
I believe you.
But you see that dead team with 15 in these? The problems that gave you all last night put y'all into overtime. A team would only lose with 10 straight and last in the East, in number 15.
No.
Put y'all into overtime and almost beat y'all.
That was a real letdown game for the Lakers. You had the game that you had against the Clippers, and then you played the next night. That's a letdown game, man. But
the 15 in the East. A team would then lose 10, 11 straight.
Next,
playing a lot like that.
Next week, this time, you're winning, you remember the score.
And they barely
scaled. You already beat them by 3.
And they barely scaled that against Washington.
The score next week.
Yeah. But anyhow, y'all got them who beat us on us last night. We all got them tomorrow night. Y'all got Denver tomorrow. Y'all could prove what y'all good for tomorrow night.
They own the Lakers and they overdue for it. The Lakers overdue to beat them. Lakers can beat them tomorrow night.
Yeah, and we can beat the Jazz. We get the Jazz. But I thought Hero would have been back, man. That knee still a little stiff. And Love, Hero and Love, that 30 points right there we short off, man. That's the only way they get away. But let me hang up, because I want Skillaboo to get in, boy. Skillaboo got in. Skillaboo ready.
Yeah, I got a call.
I'm calling in right now for you, Naughty.
I'm waiting on the call.
Hey, but you never, y'all have a safe weekend, man. We get together. Finally, I go WhatsApp you. Legally.
Yeah, legally.
After that Lakers game tomorrow, I got to WhatsApp you. All right, legally, come by.
I just did.
All right.
Hey, Muff text me 2 o'clock in the morning.
Wait, I drop sleep, and then when I wake up after the game, that late game, and then I see, yo, what's up? So before I move from my man cave into the master bedroom, I just text you back. Before I go to my bed.
I got you.
I go up.
That was really cute, right, man. I like that, man.
Yeah.
When I moved from the man cave to the bastard bedroom, I text you, boy, I tell you, boy, your love fans is killing me. But anyway.
Fortunately, my man cave is my master bedroom.
But I'm bump. Listen, now I tell you the march gauntlet starts, though, Purdy. They just got the Nuggets, the Thunder, the Kings, the Bucks, Timberwolves, Kings, Warriors. Them seven right there could be tough.
They go 5-2, I'd be comfortable.
Then you got the Hawks, Sixers, and Pacers to catch yourself. Then you got the Bucks. And
you
the
never
Nets.
Know which Bucks. You never know which Bucks team gonna show up.
Correct. Then you make it to April, you might be able to wiggle your way in. But I tell you,
they got these. They got about 22 more games or 27 more games left. They got to play some ball.
Anyhow, let's go to the phone lines. Talking Heads, Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. Who's that? Talking Heads.
Yes, Mr. Naughty.
Hey, what's going on? This Skillo?
Hey, what is that?
Hey, bro, what's happening? You know, I had to make sure you
hear what he's saying. Muff Jai put me under the bus?
No, but Skillo, before we go.
Naughty Radio.
No, but Skillo, hold on, Skillo.
Yeah,
all this time you've been calling the show, you should have told me that was you, because I know the voice sounded familiar, you know.
Yeah, but
I said, wonder if that's old Skill, man. Baby, guess what? Yeah, I called it by Anton today, and it wasn't Anton, right? So I didn't want to make that mistake. But how you doing, man?
He was telling me, I was text you. It ain't me naughty.
No, Skiller, we good, man. We good. When they brought it up, right?
Yeah.
One thing that I always remember about playing in Mason, right? Mm-hmm. The games were always good. You all had a little shorter three-point line. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So I used to like play there, especially on the basket closest from the curb right there. You know what I mean? Close down to where they used to have the horse and carriage track.
Right, right.
The games used to be nice. And people used to come out, actually, and watch. It used to be like a little crowd. You know, it used to be a good little run.
It's not like a little stadium.
But you were one of the legends out there, boy. Skillo, you was bad boy, man. I take nothing from you, man.
Yeah, but then I really was talking concerning we came back to the Lakers now. You remember 2 weeks ago I tell you and Burley that LeBron.
Yeah.
We need LeBron to go into the playoffs. We're going to need LeBron.
Right.
Let me tell you why, Naughty. LeBron is a veteran. Right now, I don't know if you listened to my boy yesterday. Your boy. Carl, what do you name?
Oh, Stephen A. Smith?
No, not Stephen, man.
Oh, Colin
Coward.
Last night, yeah.
You heard Colin said?
Yeah.
Concerning LeBron.
What did Herd have to say? What Colin had to say? What did he have to say?
He said, right now, LeBron is the second best player in the fourth quarter. Next to Giannis.
That may be so.
Yes, and the thing about it, Naughty, let me show you something. I hear Muff talking about the Heat's get beat, and this one cost them lose, and this one do that, and da 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 da. And then he talk about how we barely win that game yesterday. Like Foyle say, that's a back-to-back, right? And I know they was going to have a little struggle in that game. That's how the league. You watch all of their back-to-back games. It always be a struggle. Either they win or they lose. And they lose. If they lose, they lose by either someone miss a shot or something like that. But, Naughty, I guarantee you, tomorrow, Lakers can win that game. And you see all the teams would be playing moving forward.
Yeah.
All them is teams over 500. Or in the 3 seed is a 2 seed.
Right.
Or 1 seed, right?
Right.
And that's when LeBron and AD is shine best. Now, all we need is the support of them, the support and gas, to show up.
Once like I've been saying all year, the bench got to score up.
Like Wiley say, we could win at least about 7 or 8 of them over the last 12. I think it's more, but 12 or 11 more games. But they can be playing at home. All
right.
Them home games now. Remember that?
Yeah, we got the next 6 games at home.
Right. Try looking for some in at least about 5 or 6 of them over the 12. How much that'll be, Pearly? 11, 8?
No, we got, the Lakers got, I'll tell you how much they got left. They got, for this month, they got, I can tell you right now.
Home games.
In total, they have 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12, 14, 16, 18, 20, 21 games left.
Right.
And out of that, they got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12 at home. So they almost got half at home.
One game. So if they can win at least.
The good thing about the Lakers games is the month of April, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, the last 7 games in April, the Raptors, the Wizards, the Cavaliers, the Timberwolves, the Warriors, the Grizzlies, the Pelicans, all of them games are winnable games, except maybe the tough ones will be the Timberwolves and the Pelicans. But the rest of them, they could win.
They could go on that March-April run that they went on last year and do well.
If they get it strong together, they might move up too.
Yeah, because... Like I said yesterday, all they got to do is win another 3-4 games and beat, what the damn name what you telling me, Boyle?
The Pelicans, eh?
Was it the Pelicans
I was telling you?
Yeah, Pelicans is playing good ball.
The 6th seed. Which one in the 6th seed right now?
The 6th seed would be, that's the Pelicans. Yeah, the Pelicans.
Pelicans okay.
Number 6.
Yeah. Right.
See, Dallas number 7, Sacramento number 8, Lakers number 9. We basically tie in the win column with the Kings. The Kings just play less games than us. They get 25 losses. We get 28 losses. And the Mavericks, we 1 game behind the Mavericks in the win column. 2 games behind the Pelicans in the win column.
If we could win a couple more games straight and beat Pelicans, and we'd be sitting in
everyone in front of the Lakers, they're going to play this month. The Kings, the Mavericks, the Pelicans.
The Lakers control their destiny. They do control their destiny. I give them that.
Yeah. See, and you see that boy when they pick up?
Get ready.
He's getting his feet on the ground.
That's what I'm saying. The minute you see he start, because they're the kind of players with LeBron like. Fellas with could shoot.
I think he was a good pickup. I think that was a good move the Lakers made.
That's an excellent pickup. I mean, no, my boy, to hurry up, get here, little boy, Bailey.
Gabe Vincent, eh? Yeah. You need him.
Man, he's a good defender and a good 3-point threat.
But don't look like he's coming back. Season almost over. He ain't back here.
No, but they say he's supposed to be coming back at least next week sometime, you know.
Okay.
Yeah, they say he's supposed to be coming back next week or week after next. But he can be back.
If he don't come back this month, I don't want him.
I
don't want him back.
I know who might come back right now.
Who?
Vanderbilt.
Yeah, he's going to be out a little while more.
Yeah.
But listen,
Reddick came back night before last. So Reddick played the last 2 games.
Yeah, where's Naughty?
I'm glad I got you on the phone. I had a conversation in the barbershop the other day.
Uh-huh.
And we were talking about local Bahamian basketball, you know, like park legends, right?
Right.
And I had to bring, they was talking about forwards and this and that. I said, listen, a lot of y'all don't know, but there was a young man in Mason. He used to play on Mason Park. Fell hard on substance abuse, but could have been an NBA player. I'm talking about Maggie Jason. You remember Maggie?
Yeah, man.
Did he not have like an Otis Thorpe body? Like I had an Otis Thorpe. Did he not have that NBA game long time?
Listen to me. Maggie had the 3-point touch way before Steph even. Nope. And just what? Steph wasn't even ready for Maggie.
And Maggie was.
Maggie, you had to guide him from the left side of the court, because the minute he reached by half court, he pulling up.
And guess what? He's about 6'6", 6'7", right?
Oh, Maggie?
Yeah.
I know Maggie was that tall.
At least 6'5". I 6'3", he was taller than me. So
Jason was taller than you?
Yeah, by 6'4", 6'5", easy.
Okay, well, I know Maggie had a good height on him, but I didn't know.
Right, Maggie,
I can tell you the honest
Maggie
truth.
Had a game, too, and back to the bucket game, too. Had a nice turnaround, too.
He was a real threat. Trust me. But you talking about Maggie Jason, you remember Magoo?
Oh, yeah.
Magoo was the point guard.
Magoo was the guard with all the tricks.
Exactly. Isaiah Thomas said he had nothing on Magoo.
Nothing on Magoo,
boy.
And Magoo would drop down in the game and dribble around on his knee and do something foolishness to make you look giddy.
Listen to me. The Bahamas have some great ball players.
Real talk.
In the 80s and in the 90s and thing, but
I tell you.
Honestly.
We did.
You remember one fella named Elijah McSweeney?
I heard the name, but that might be a little before my time, Skiller.
Listen to me.
He was considered probably the greatest basketball player in the country at the time.
Exactly. Michael Thompson, that was a joke to that nigga.
It's easy to eat Michael for breakfast, I heard.
Boy,
that nigga used to eat, you remember Dacry Johnson?
Yeah, boy. Yes. The bridge in, the bridge in, boy.
Dacry, right? You know they have to be good.
Ace.
This boy, Elijah McSweeney, you know who he used to get on like in the NBA? Karl Malone.
Oh, yeah. Big Paul Malone.
Yeah, now that you brought that up, yeah.
I think it was crazy.
I had a cousin out of Freeport Basel, the kid signs. Now, that brother could
listen
shoot.
To me. Pretty, don't go there. Don't go. Naughty, you can't shoot. Tell me you ain't no, the kid.
Yeah, man. Come on.
The kid
that's
is my godbrother.
The best shooters.
The kid, mommy, is my godmother.
All right. All right. But see, I would be remiss if I didn't throw into the question you want to talk shooters, because I used to have the battles with him at Breezes when we worked down there. And somebody who considers me a shooter, and I also consider him a shooter, and I'll put him up in any shooting contest when I get a chance, out of Freeport, too, Julian Swish Coakley.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Former
yeah,
MVP of Hugh Campbell, but Julian Swish could light it up, too. But.
Let me throw another name at you.
And don't forget Clayton Smiley Miller, too. Smiley could have chewed it up, too, boy.
Listen to me.
And hey, Richie the Coupier, ugly.
Oh, hold on. And Skiller, here we go. Ricky Kool-Aid Ferguson, buddy.
Stop that.
All right. Craig Magic Walker. Let me throw a couple more names at you.
All our shooters stick together, brother. All our shooters stick together.
Hold on. Watch this, Pearly. Watch this. You live in Chippenham, right?
Yes, all my life.
I want to shoot some
players. Lorenzo Carter, the greatest thing ever come out of Chippenham playing basketball, right?
The greatest athlete, because that brother could do baseball, softball, cycling,
yeah, that's what he was good at. He wasn't really, so to say, top of the class basketball player. He was like an all-around player.
Yeah.
Made him, but you know who was one of the awesomest players with a tripping arm? I don't know. Do you remember Kung Fu?
Yes, I was going to say, guys, waiting on you to say that name. Yes,
yes. Mate.
Yes.
Let's say that's the nigga would teach me how to jump and how to get up.
Yeah, but yes. He got a fly.
You get a... You gotta put a dollar on the top of the backboard chain and leave change on it.
Baby, it's Skiller. We gotta get you on one day next week or in the near future and let's talk some park legends, man.
Yeah,
we gotta get to the break now. And we got
awesome.
We got Colin Cowherd taking us home today, man. And Colin's giving the full breakdown of the NFL offseason. All right?
Okay, bro.
Okay.
And real quick,
Skiller, we gotta get you on. Get you and a couple other fellas on.
Yeah, man. So with that being said, we'll
Naughty. I share this with you and Pearly sometimes year before last when I just place get everything sorted out, right?
Right.
You know, I have an organization right now, right? Name WOW Expression of Love Foundation.
Okay. Right?
All right. And what I do is I go into the inner cities and reach out to the less fortunate.
Well, you need to come on and talk about that as well too, man.
That's what I want to hook up with you with.
All right, no problem, man. Give us a buzz next week like you always do, and we'll line something up, man, in the near future, very near future.
Okay, bro.
All right?
Yeah.
Be safe, man, and good day from your Skiller, man. And you know, whatever you need, I got you, bro.
Oh, yeah, I've been listening to you every day, man.
But I thought I was really
calling just about every day, but like you say, I don't be telling you.
Yeah, but now I know. Now I got you down, so you know there's plenty smack on talk now, brother. Buckle up.
Okay.
Be safe.
Okay,
you and the farm have a great weekend, man. Bye. You too, bro. Be safe.
Take care, Skiller, bro.
Pearly, I can let you get back to the repass because I hear getting good now. They might touch your food. We got Colin Cowherd.
No, I don't take my plate up. I don't take my extra plate to get my mother hold for me. But yeah,
we'll see you on Monday, man. All right? And have a great weekend, my brother.
Yeah. All right.
Condolences to the family. Bring my plate.
Yes, sir. Not a problem.
All right, man. We hit the break. Flip side of the break. Colin Cowherd taking us home. Have a great weekend, Bahamas. We see you Monday.
John Shoes and Accessories is your one-stop shop for all your footwear needs. You will find what you're looking for among the growing collection of classic and trendy styles with new arrivals every week. John's covers the whole family and has great prices, helpful and friendly customer service. Your experience shopping with us will be time well spent. Shop with us online at www.johnshoes.com. John's also now carries small home appliances. So come on into John's, located on Rosetta Street in Palmdale and Carmichael Road West. John's, we put fashion at your feet.
Cancer Treatment Centers of America is now City of Hope, creating one of the leading cancer care and research networks from coast to coast, providing more of what you need. More locations means more care closer to home. More specialists means more expertise.
More research means more breakthroughs. More advancements means more treatment options. And more options means more hope. Learn more at cancercenter.com.
Just because they were on sale, Max bought things that he and his friend really didn't need. Hungry for deals? Let KFC satisfy your cravings before you do something crazy. Get a KFC 6-piece value deal with 6 pieces of juicy fried chicken, 3 orders of crispy fries, and 3 buttery biscuits, all for only $20. Order your new favorite deal online with Messenger or WhatsApp Hi to 557-3663 to start your KFC order today. Nobody does value like KFC, and it's finger-licking good.
Refined style with elegant taste, then fine threads is your place. If you want those slacks hemmed or just taking the waist, then fine threads is your place. If you want to look suave and debonair everywhere you go, like you're supposed to be in a video. Want to step out and look great? Then fine threads is your place. Refined style with elegant taste, then fine threads is your place. Is your place. Is your place.
Play with Island Games.
We making dreams come true.
Play with Island Games.
We paying more out to you. Don't mind the noise in the market. You getting cash in your pocket.
Cause Island Games is spicy, and spicy is tradition.
So when you play,
play Island Games,
we putting Bahamian's voice guaranteed to pay.
Island Games.
We like them other jokers. We've been here from the start, from the bike to computer.
Island Games.
We gonna make your dreams come true.
We playing with Island Games.
Around the world, Cleveland Clinic is recognized as a leader in healthcare. Our team of experts relentlessly pursues the best for our patients. From groundbreaking cancer research to state-of-the-art heart surgery, life-saving innovations happen here every day. When it's time to travel for your health, it's time to travel to Cleveland Clinic, your destination for care. For every care in the world. To learn more, visit clevelandclinic.org/Caribbean.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, quality.
John Middlecoff now joining me, as he does from time to time. So it's interesting. I hear, I see all the GMs you talk to, but coaches, it's interesting. Some go, some don't. What's your take on that as a former NFL scout?
Yeah, it's not even some. I mean, it's a lot of the Shanahan crew, right? It's Kyle, it's Sean McVay, it's Matt LaFleur, Robert Saleh. I don't think was planning on going, and there were some articles written, and it feels like he kind of got forced into the deal. So I think this, it's pretty simple. If Tom Brady's working out and you're a quarterback, you should probably be working out. If Tiger Woods is hitting golf balls and you're trying to beat him on the golf course, you should probably be on the range. If Andy Reid is going to be at the combine, he's a back-to-back Super Bowl champ. He's been going to this thing for 40 years. And he told me, I talked to him for a long time. He said, the value in this is not the workouts for me anymore. We get that on tape. I'm not a doctor. I have nothing to do with. I simply go for, I think the number now is 45 interviews, that when Chris Jones or Trent McDuffie or whoever we like in the draft is walking through that door, I get 15 minutes, and it's my first interaction to meet a guy that my scouts have met throughout the fall, that I have loosely watched or have an idea because Veach has given me, but I get to interact. Remember that famous video of Pete Carroll a long time ago? Another guy, he's out of the league. He never missed this thing.
Yeah,
took off his shirt with DK Metcalf. Those interactions are big, and I obviously the old school guys value them, and the new school guys, you know, are in Cabo having a cocktail.
Yeah. So your overview of the combine, you hear the whispers, guys are going out, they're having beers, they're having steaks, they're talking, people loosen up a little bit. What is the overview of the draft, especially in the first couple rounds, about the talent, what's good, what's not, what's under and overvalued?
Yeah, I think obviously the wide receiver class is very, very highly thought of. I think these quarterbacks are very intriguing. You know, it reminds me a little bit. And again, there's a difference between the hype and the prospects coming into a draft and then how we view it. Remember, once upon a time, the Trevor Lawrence, Zach Wilson, Trey Lance, Justin Fields draft and Mac Jones was viewed, all those guys got drafted high, but now we kind of laugh at it. But it was viewed as a really good quarterback draft. This quarterback draft, obviously is much more, there's much more substance behind it because all these guys have played in Power Five for a long time, starters. But there are a lot of opinions out there. I mean, I was out having some cocktails with a bunch of scouts that do these regions. A guy that did the South, and it's just, you can't argue that Jaden Daniels is really, really talented, but would you feel really good about taking him number two overall? And that was, you know, one thing you hear down there is the buzz about Washington potentially taking him two overall. Cliff Kingsbury, more of a spread offense. You know, Drake May is a very, very intriguing prospect, though, when you watch him. And I did a couple games, like, I don't really see it. But then when he, this is what we talk about, when you meet him for the first time, the size, part of the draft, too, is projecting, right? So can I improve on the flaws that he had as an offensive coach, as a head coach, as an organization? And I think everyone, you know, views Caleb as the 100% lock at number one, and obviously the domino of Justin Fields. I think a lot of people think Atlanta, but, you know, right now and over the course of this week, there are a lot of secret meetings going on in hotel rooms. And until something is official, everyone's in the mix. And obviously there are a ton of teams that need quarterbacks. So to me, Justin Fields, there are going to be a lot of teams sniffing around. I think it's all about the value, right? How much is he going to actually get traded for?
So the Giants are a fascinating team, John, because they need perimeter weapons. But if Drake May falls, and many are, every draft, we get a star that falls. We've seen Marino, Aaron Rodgers. I'm not saying Drake May's that, but there's a lot of talk about his inconsistency, and there's a lot of J.J. McCarthy fans. So let's say Drake May falls a little, five spots. Mike Garofalo, NFL Network, says he believes the Giants will take a quarterback and then sit him behind Daniel Jones. And I made the argument earlier, Daniel Jones and Justin Fields, the only difference is one has a better offensive coach and has won one playoff game. They're the same guy. They're hurt too much. They're inaccurate. They run but get sacked a lot. It's weird. So my take is the Giants are a fascinating team. They need a receiver, but it's chock full, and I believe they have 2 second-round picks. There can be plenty of receivers. What is your guess? What did you hear about the Giants who, you know, they're stuck with Daniel for a year, but after that they can wiggle?
I think there's going to be a lot of pressure on this organization. That, you know, obviously not the ownership, but the coach and the GM to be competitive this year, because this was a team that had back-to-back coaches not last 2 years each. So Brian Daboll, what just happened? Listen, how could you not? What happened 2 years ago to be competitive with a roster that was pretty average? But last year was a disaster. So you take a rookie quarterback, Washington is going to be better than they've been. And obviously the Eagles and the Cowboys, a lot is going on, but they're in a different universe than the Giants. So you take a quarterback really early. We'll see on Daniel Jones' health. Can you compete to go above 500? Because to me, if you have a season where you're winning 7 or less games, like John Mara has shown, they will move through coaches.
Yes.
So I think sometimes these head coaches, maybe he goes, listen, can we just get Daniel Jones back, play better, improve the talent around him? Like, I wonder if you're Brian Daboll, you don't want a rookie quarterback. You would rather try to hit on 3 or 4 guys throughout the draft and have much more talent, because you got to play the Eagles and the Cowboys 4 times. And like we all know, their rosters, the gap is really wide. And even Washington now is going to be much more a streamlined organization, high-level people. Everyone's on the same page, new ownership. It's going to be difficult. So I don't know. I could see the ownership and the organization thinking big picture, but I could see the head coach wanting position players that can help him win September 10th.
So J-Mac noted this earlier. So Caleb Williams, who I think we both like, but there's no perfect player out of college. He doesn't even want to do the physical at the combine. You know, there's the fingernail thing. There's the jumping in the crowd with his mom and crying thing. It doesn't bother me. It's a different generation. I can get over that fast. I like him. I've met him 3 or 4 times. I like him a lot. But there is, you know, you start nitpicking people, John. You're a former NFL scout, Philadelphia Eagles. You're looking for little things. And the more I read on Caleb, now he's not going to take the physical. Well, everybody does that. What do we make of that?
Well, the fingernail thing was, I mean, pretty embarrassing. There's no way around that. But that was 2 years ago, and then this year he doesn't do it. Listen, we're guys. We mature at slower speeds. I watched him talk today about the medical stuff, because when I saw the headline on social media, I thought, oh, here we go. You know, it feels very NBA-ish. And then I watched him talk, and he actually was – I thought he explained it pretty well.
Yeah.
I'm going to take full physicals with teams that I know are going to draft me. Once upon a time, Deion Sanders, I think it was like the New York Giants, wanted him to take some cognitive tests, and he said, what pick do you have? Pick 9? You're not going to draft me. I actually don't think it's as weird. I do think it would have been a huge red flag if he says, under no circumstances, I'm going to get physical. But the way he said, I have no problem doing it to the Bears, to Washington, maybe to 2 or 3 teams that have a chance to have to trade up to get him. But, like, why should the Raiders have his medical? That doesn't bother me as much. I think it's more intriguing about him as a prospect. Talking to scouts that have gone through there, they feel pretty good about him as a person. I think it's more about, can he play in the construct of an offense? Can the hero ball stuff, which he was forced to do at USC, can you rein it in a little bit? Part of Mahomes, and that's where he gets compared to a lot, like the raw tools and kind of reining it all in to become a complete player. Well, he got Andy Reid, right? He got to go to the Kansas City Chiefs. That's not going to happen here. He's going to go to the Chicago Bears. So I think there's just going to be a ton of pressure on that organization. You and I have talked about this. What if they start 1-4? Their coach could get fired. But it doesn't seem like, you know, Caleb's open to going there. And I think the physical tools are not debatable, right? The arm strength, the movement, his athleticism. But like you said, I mean, most people are not Andrew Luck, right? Which was the close to his can't miss as I've ever seen in my life. This guy, like a lot of really good